had a manifesto and a vision and mission that had been approved by my party, by the highest body of
my party. We have to take pride on how we've handled
the illegal entry of persons coming in from Martinique, and Martinique remains an area of higher risk for
when
us
because...
campaigning,
you see all the nice things, all the appealing things, all the emotional things to touch people's heart because you want them to support you and follow you, you inspire them, you give them hope.
But what about the culture of people getting to office and not being effective in terms of
portfolio?
No, but caller, hold on.
Who handled his portfolio?
Hold on.
Let's do it this Wednesday, because if it's Wednesday, it's Newsmic Alive.
Good evening to you. Welcome to the broadcast News Make Alive on DBS Television. With me, Timothy Polium. Of course, we go up until 10 o'clock this evening, at which time we conclude with the clip that peaked. And we have a very sensitive and controversial subject to discuss on the broadcast this afternoon or this evening. I have two special guests, and we're talking about comprehensive sexuality education, where, for example, people with different sexual orientations. Those issues, subjects will be discussed, will be exposed to students in the education system. That is the fear, and definitely calls are being made for the various entities, the Ministry of Education and others, to ensure that they consult parents in the event that any decision is taken to include such subject matters in the school curriculum. My guests this evening is Fremont Lawrence of Freedom Coalition St. Lucia and Mr. Jason Tama, a concerned parent. Welcome to the program.
Thank you. Welcome for having us, Tim.
Yeah, good evening.
Why are you so concerned when the CSE, Comprehensive Sexuality Education, has not been included in our school curriculum in St. Lucia or in other parts of the Caribbean? All we have, you would see, for example, certain books dealing with the controversial subject matters, but they are not on the book list, such as Let's Talk About Sex, Changing Bodies, Growing Up, Sex and Sexual Health. That's a new edition, 20th anniversary, and authors Robbie H. Harris and Michael Emberley.
Well, you know, Tim, we are fully aware of the impact that American culture has on the Caribbean. We know that in the Caribbean, whatever happens in America is observed very acutely by citizens of the Caribbean, and many practices and many habits are adopted as a result of people's exposure to American television. And we see in America right now, there is a growing, and my particular concern is that there is a growing agenda as far as the trans movement is concerned. And as I watch television and as I do my research, I see increasingly there is an attack on children, that not only is it a matter for adults, because adults can do whatever they want to their bodies, but when you are beginning to attack the innocence of children and not allowing parents to have any input in how the children are taught about sex, and then it means that we must be concerned, because ultimately it's going to come to the Caribbean. Already we know it's happening in Trinidad, and we have information that perhaps this is being considered in Barbados, and we believe that perhaps sooner rather than later it will get to St. Lucia. Now, when you know a storming...
But my information that it has not been included in the school curriculum over in Trinidad.
Yes.
It has not.
Well, for now, mm-hmm. for now. But as I said, the influence of the American culture and the American educational system is going to find its way into the Caribbean. And to me, I see this as a storm that is approaching. You don't wait until the storm hits you to prepare for that storm. You prepare for the storm before that storm hits you. And so we're making people aware of what is happening and what is likely to be influencing our schools and our school children in our country.
But Mr. Thomas, since we are considered to be a religious people, not only St. Lucia, but indeed the Caribbean, one gets the impression that this time around, matters relating to same-sex marriage, people abhor that. I mean, in your experience in St. Lucia, people just avoid, they're not accepting it. People also, there's certain things that people are just not going to accept along their principles and their morals and their values, although they're more tolerant when it comes to other things. But in this particular case, what gives him the impression that you have to be so proactive as to appear on this broadcast and to speak on this matter?
Well, Tim, the thing is, parents have been talking. So it's not just something that has been happening, you know, recently. Parents have been discussing in different groups. Fremont and I know each other for almost 2 years, and these topics have come up. Like he's saying, there's a proliferation of this material. You've seen it on billboards. You've seen a lot of gender issues being discussed. You've seen, you know, and I think the public, the concerned public, the parents, we don't have that dialogue. We don't have that opportunity to express, well, you know, is there a concern? And it's not about thrusting down any belief system on anybody. It's just a matter of why target the children? And we've seen that even in the U.S.
But how are the children being targeted? Let's say St. Lucia, in the case of St. Lucia. How are the children being targeted?
Well, in the case of St. Lucia, we're not seeing this in our curriculum, like you rightfully said. But the fact that these books can appear on our shelves, for example, like this particular book, one of the pages actually recommends masturbation. Would you recommend that for your 10-year-old?
I don't think so. But if I have a 10-year-old, I would want my 10-year-old to know about it.
Yes, but
it's almost inevitable at some point in time because of the phone, the exposure to social media, interacting with other students. He or she will eventually know about it at some point in time.
Well, what we found with some of these books, there are little innuendos in there that recommend these things to the children. So it doesn't tell you to, you know, like, okay, well, it's good for you and it's healthy, but it normalizes it to a certain extent. So with a curious 10-year-old, what do you think they will do? You know, considering that, I mean, children like that lack experience. So at that tender age, you know, why would you introduce something like gender? You know, like we see happening, like Fremont was talking about in Barbados. You know, these things coming up, you know, and the fact that it's hitting closer and closer to home. We don't want to wait for this to be legislated and to be passed as a bill and we don't recognize it.
But the other thing, Tim, is that while they say it is a book for 10-year-olds, a 10-year-old takes this book home. And this 10-year-old has siblings that are younger. Clearly, children have a natural curiosity, okay? And they might want to experiment with the siblings. And so we are exposing children to sexuality and to a depth of sexuality which we believe is they're not quite prepared for emotionally, psychologically, mentally. And you are aware, Tim, that there is a growing problem of pedophilia in the world. We will be talking about that tonight. And we believe that all of this can contribute to the problem of pedophilia, which is a big problem. And we believe that, as I said earlier on, what happens in the metropolitan countries is eventually filtering down to the Caribbean. So we must prepare ourselves for that kind of influence.
But don't you think that this thing has been in existence for a very long time in more developed parts of the world, the United States, talking about same-sex marriage and people openly practicing certain things like being gay, queer, etc. That if we had this proclivity in St. Lucia, if we had this tolerance for it, by now it clearly would have been all over the place on the island in the Caribbean.
Yeah, my main concern is with the children, right? As far as I'm concerned, adults can decide what they want to do with the bodies. All right? If I don't hate people who are homosexual, I don't hate lesbians, that is the lifestyle that they have chosen. I will not advocate violence against them. I will not advocate that they be treated any less than human. But my main concern is with children, and particularly the transgender movement that tries to indoctrinate our children even before that they have the mental maturity and the analytical ability to make a decision about their bodies and whether they want to be male or female. That is my concern.
But to a certain extent, Mr. Tama, aren't we already exposed to this, the children in particular, through the human and family life education, HFLE, that's being taught in our schools?
Well, I don't know what is being taught now, Tim. I mean, you went to school. Were you ever exposed to the graphic pictures that you saw in that book tonight?
No.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So the fact that...
But don't you think we should be evolving?
Yeah, but to what point? Like, I'll give you an example. Right now in the U.S., you could be a five-year-old. I don't know if all the states do it, but you can be a five-year-old and you decide you want to change. You know, if you wake up one day and you don't feel like being a boy anymore, you can become a girl. So, I mean, where does that end?
But by parents educating, but by educating our children that such things do exist, you could have sex transplant, etc. You can decide tomorrow to be, if you're a girl, you decide you want to be a boy, and vice versa, etc. Isn't it important that we expose our children to this very early in their lives, to tell them that those things do exist, and at some point in time, you might have to decide whether you want to be male or female?
There is a danger. Mm-hmm. The thing is the role of parents in this whole issue. The role of parents is being undermined. In the United States right now, in certain states like California and other states, they're telling parents that you have no right. If the child has the right to decide what the child wants to be in terms of the child's gender, and they're telling children, without the knowledge of the parents, that you can be whatever you want to be. Let me give you an example. Tim, in California right now, they are piloting legislation. They're trying to pilot legislation for the state legislature, such that if a little girl comes home and the little girl tells the mother, "Mom, I think I'm a boy, and I would like to be a boy," and the mother says, "No, Jill, you're not a boy. You're a girl, and you will always be a girl," and the little girl goes to the dad now and tells the dad, "Mom, Dad, I want to be a boy, and my mom is saying, no, I have to be a girl." And then the father says, "No, you can be whatever you want to be." So clearly that will create conflict between the two parents. Now, the legislation is structured such that if it creates conflict and the child reports that to the school, the matter goes to court. And the legislation is so structured that the court will award custody of this child to the parent who wants the child to go to transform into the trans. So it is designed to undermine parental authority, parental harmony. It is designed to undermine the family, and I believe ultimately our society. And that is the danger. That is the danger, because right now, if a child says, again in California and some states, the child says, "I want to be something that I'm not," and the parents oppose it, they say, "You're abusing the child. You're not honoring the child's rights." And the state can take over the child. Okay, so just like you have in America, they want to impose their values upon us because they can use the big stick to do so. I think we must begin to make ourselves aware of the potential danger and prepare ourselves for what is to come.
And can I also add?
Yeah.
Imagine a child, like let's say 12 years old.
Mm-hmm.
She decides, you know, she wants to make that switch. What happens when she's 30 years old? What happens when she's 40 years old? Let's just say she wants to switch back. Right now, there's a growing population in the U.S. and other parts of the world that are regretting, so to speak, and are finding themselves in, you know, in therapist rooms, and, you know, basically their lives are destroyed because you reverse something that is natural to you. You put in hormones that doesn't belong, and at the end of the day, your body is working against it. So when you're a child and you make that decision at such a young, tender age, when you know, decide you want to no longer be that anymore, you know how children are, can make very impulsive, you know, decisions. So at the end of the day, that danger of not being able to reverse, that irreversible damage that you cause, I mean, can you tell a child, you know, at that point in time?
That you're making reference to there. You believe that, gentlemen, that we are so sophisticated, and I don't think we are so sophisticated in terms of the science, in terms of whatever advancements that are exposed to us, the technology that exposed that are available to us, for this to happen anytime soon in St. Lucia, sex changes?
Well, it's available in other parts of the world. Mm-hmm. So it's just a matter of time before it reaches here. I mean, the technology doesn't take that long nowadays to trickle down. It's just a matter of somebody having enough money to open up a clinic and offer that service to young people.
But Mr. Lawrence, in this particular case, do you think that politicians will go against the wishes of the people? And I could just see people, in this particular instance, agitating vociferously, strongly against any legislation that would take away the rights of parents to determine whether these children have a right to determine whether they want to have a sex change or not.
Well, we're putting the politicians on notice. I think we have to, because sometimes the politicians, before the during the campaign, they tell you they'll be the servants, right? They will do what is in the best interest of the people. But when they get into power, then they forget that they have told you they would be the servants and they become your masters. So we're putting the politicians on notice that this is a possibility, and we're telling you that we don't want it. I honestly believe, Tim, that 95% of St. Lucians are opposed to the transgender ideology. And again, I have to go back to America, because it's happening more in America than even in Europe. There is a deliberate effort. There's a deliberate effort to indoctrinate children into the transgender ideology. It's not if, because they have people who are counseling teachers on how to sway the children's minds. And children are being told, children are being given information about this without their parents knowing. Sometimes many months have passed and the parents know nothing about it. And when it comes to the parents' attention and they go to the school, they're told, well, that is what we want for the children. And by that time, they have so influenced the child against the parents that some of the children even say they don't want to stay with the parents. Because, as I said, I think this whole thing is designed to undermine parental authority. And we know, again, I'm going to the point I have made, we know what impact that American values have on the Caribbean.
But right? I think that this indoctrination that you fear, that fear
that you're making reference to, is unwarranted, because children in the family analysis, they have to be exposed to those things. They have to be educated. There's a particular era when we did not want the sale of condoms to take place in pharmacies and other establishments for fear that there would be wanton sex. Children would just have, and young people would just have sex outside of marriage and so on. When it was meant to merely educate people about having safe sex and being responsible, the church would enter the fray and say, why expose people to easily access a condom when you do not want to preach people having sex before marriage? The bigger issue is, in this particular instance, is like providing you with life skills and protecting yourself against diseases, HIV, etc.
But it's the age at which this is.
But at what?
Expose your children to this.
Well, we don't.
When what? When they are 15 and 20?
No. But when you tell me you're targeting a 4- and 5-year-old, what critical thinking ability and what mental maturity does a 4- or 5-year-old have to make a decision about the child's gender, about the child's sex? Because they will tell the children, well, you should be a girl, you're born in the wrong body, you have a wrong body. And I mean, I was watching a video about two doctors making a presentation to Congress, and one doctor is saying that a child's sex is determined at birth, which is ridiculous. A child's sex is determined at conception, not at birth, because you know about the X chromosomes and the X and Y chromosomes. So it is at conception. So they're trying to present a narrative to make people believe that it is determined at birth, and so then the child, when the child reaches a certain age, the child can determine what the child wants to be. But here is something else. They're even trying, Tim, to pass legislation whereby the child's sex will not be declared at birth. They want to delay that declaration when the child is in a position to decide what sex the child wants to be. But that is after the child has gone to school and after the child has been indoctrinated, because there's an army of people who are being trained to do this. When the child has gone to school and the child has been indoctrinated, then the child will decide whether the child wants to be male or female. I think there is an age at which this matter should not be brought to the children, and that it cannot be done, it should not be done without parental influence or without an input from the parents.
What about in your interaction, in your discussions, do you think
that there will be buy-in on the part of teachers, because I could see teachers also resisting this, any attempt to include this in the school curriculum in St. Lucia, because the debate is more intense in a number of other Caribbean territories, your Jamaica.
St. Lucia, religious leaders are not speaking about it, our educators not speaking about it. But do you get a sense that our local educators would want to teach such areas, such things to our students?
To tell you the truth, Tim, because we have been advocating and we've been in the forefront, people have been coming to us, concerned teachers, for example. I know of a teacher who particularly said that if she has to teach that, she will resign. So this is how it goes. And we're talking about people who have strong religious backgrounds. Now, we're not pushing religion on anybody, because most of the transgender people, the LGBT people, will say that what we're doing is hate speech. You understand? So this is how they gain sympathy. This is not hate. We don't hate them. We don't hate what they do, because at the end of the day, I mean, we hate what they do, not them. All right? But at the end of it all, the targeting of the children, most people will say, well, you know, why not, you know, from a Christian standpoint, why not focus on the adulterers and the fornicators and all of these other things that the Bible speaks of, like you rightfully said. But these people are not advocating for this to be pushed down children's throats. These people are not advocating to take away somebody's rights so that they now, because these people more or less operate behind closed doors. You know, you have your jabal, you have your, you know, you're not interested in people knowing your business. But when it comes to the LGBT movement, they want you to accept it. They want you to celebrate it together with them. So it's no longer their right, because their right now becomes...
But this is not being done in St. Lucia, the acceptance that you're making reference to.
Well, I mean, what those people are clamoring for, they're agitating for,
you see, what
is tolerance.
What we're seeing on a global scale, Timothy, is that this is slowly but surely coming to our shores. So it's not here yet in terms of the way you're talking about it. But look at what happened in Jamaica and the rift that created between the two, the U.S. and the Jamaicans, right? Look at the fact that, you know, that we have the African countries who are
sanctioned.
Yeah, but in
the case of Jamaica, this emphasizes, this strengthens my point that we will not cower in the face of any kind of intimidation on the part, let's say, of the United States or other countries. We cannot be easily influenced when it comes to things of that nature, homosexuality and same-sex marriage. Mm-hmm. So the fact that Jamaica is standing up to the U.S. on this is indicative of probably the position that will be taken by a number of other Caribbean countries.
Yes, and we also know that the role that this played when it came to slavery, because that was done to humiliate us. So at the end of the day, we have that history and we don't want it. But the thing is, Timothy, the way the world is working now, I'm not sure if you remember a few years ago, England came at us and told us about our buggery laws and said if we don't remove it from the books, what happens?
But did we?
We didn't.
Yeah.
Right, but do we know whether or not we have been punished because of that? And if we continue on that hard line, are we going to be facing sanctions like the rest of the African countries? So we see that this is the way the UN operates. You do according to their will or else. So it's almost like we're at war with this agenda. And the fact that it's coming down to us, even when you look at the history of where this thing started, I'm not sure if you are familiar with this English writer. I think it's Alice Bailey.
No.
You know, okay. Well, she actually came up with a 10-point program, which was recommended to the United Nations, basically as a counter to Christian, or should I say Judeo-Christian traditions. So she, in her 10-point program, I'll give you one for example, take God and prayer out of the education system. We've seen that, right? Now, we also seen that together with taking away the prayer that our children are all over the place. Look at going to town now and watching the way the children interact. They're always fighting. They're always aggravated. I mean, you've seen videos, you know, porn videos showing up with children. So the children don't have that, you know, ability to have, you know, that higher power or the knowledge of that higher power, because you've taken out, you know, the basically the education of God. I'll give you another one, for example, reduce parental authority over children. This was a document that was recommended to the UN. This woman existed back in the 1800s to the early, I think it was 1949 when she died, just a year after. So she made these recommendations before the UN was actually born, during, I think it was the League of Nations.
Mm-hmm.
So these recommendations to erode, for example, let me give you another one. Okay, destroy the Judeo-Christian family structure or the traditional Christian family structure, right? Number four, if sex is free, then make abortion legal and make it easy. Don't we see that happening right now? Even the UN own document says that 50 million children are aborted every year.
But in the case of Sinusha, you're talking about abortion only being acceptable or being allowed in certain areas. In the case of incest, in the case of protecting the health of a parent, or in the case of a baby who's disabled. Not really disabled, sorry, but they have some conditions that are life-threatening.
So you think the 50 million children that are aborted is because of life-threatening situations?
I'm just looking at it from St. Lucia's, a lot of what you're making reference to from the stand on our own and take our own positions, particularly along moral and principle lines.
Well, you know, I would like to refer to what you said earlier about teachers. Teachers are not just teachers, they're also parents.
Mm-hmm.
Many teachers are also parents. And I don't think our teachers would stand for their authority as teachers and as parents to be undermined and to be told that they have no say in how children are educated about sex. And as I said earlier on, Tim, the concern that we all should have is how early our children are being sexualized. They're being allowed, they're being shown images, and they're being told in very, very graphic ways about sex when they are not ready for that energy to be developed in them. Okay? Now, let me give you an example of...
But continue. The case of this book, let's talk about sex, which is not in the curriculum. I'm just stressing this, okay?
Yeah.
This cannot be taught in the nation's schools.
Mm.
But it says there for age 10 and up.
Yes.
Wouldn't you recommend that children from 10 and up read this?
The parents have to have a say.
Mm-hmm.
Now you cannot say that, give it to children without the parental...
No, but your own perspective of this is concerned, because you're talking about somebody who's 10 is about to enter secondary education, secondary school.
Mm. It doesn't matter.
Be exposed to this.
It doesn't matter, but this parent, this child is under my roof.
Mm-hmm.
I have the authority over this child, to feed the child, to clothe the child, to look after the child's welfare, and I believe as a parent, I have the authority, and I should have an input in determining how the child is educated about sex. That is the concern, that the parents are being sidelined, and the child who does not have the mental capacity, the analytical ability to make decisions about sex, is being taught certain things that the child is not ready for.
But do you think that applies to children, to all children? Are there some children who are precocious, who are well developed before a particular age?
That is so, but still it should not preclude the parental input. Whether you're precocious or not, the parents need to have a say, and the teachers need to have a say in what is in how the children are going to be educated about sex. I was watching a video, Tim, about a parent who went into a school board meeting, okay? And the parent began to read from a book that was authorized by the school board for use by the children. And what he was reading was so graphic in terms of the sexual act that the chairman of the board asked him to stop. And he said, why do you ask me to stop? Because this is what you have recommended. This is the book that you have that for our children to read in the schools. If it is so offensive to you, you think it's okay for our children? And the parents did not have any input in the kind of information that was contained in the book. Do you think that this is right? Here you have allowed a book to be used by children, and when the parent is reading from this same book, you say it is offensive to you, but it's okay for our children. And that is where the influence of the parents must not be undermined. Parents and teachers must insist that they need to have an input in how children are going to be educated about sex.
Yeah, I want to continue on the point of the 10-point program that Alice Bailey outlined. And when it comes to homosexuality, which is number 6, she says make homosexuality a lifestyle. Alice Bailey preached that sexual enjoyment is the highest pleasure in humanity. No one must be denied, no one must be restricted on how they enjoy themselves. People should be allowed in whichever way they choose, they want, whether it is homosexuality, incest, bestiality, as long as the two agree. There's no control in this. I mean, she says, mentions bestiality, homosexuality, incest. There's no control. Who are we to
but
say?
Again, in the case of Sinusha, those are illegal. In the case of homosexuality, it is
or bestiality,
act,
yes.
Is illegal.
Yes.
Okay, burglary. But in the case of bestiality, it is also illegal to do so. I'm wondering why, I mean, you're going through those points when it does not apply to Sinusha. We have not succumbed to that kind of thinking.
Well, not yet, Timothy. That's the thing,
that's
because
the
this program is basically sweeping all around the globe. And there's a lot of talk going on between government, intergovernment agencies, talking about this, pressuring us within our own, you know, domain to legalize these things. So it's not just a matter of, okay, we're seeing these things and there's no fear. There is a fear. We also want to knock on the doors on the churches, because we spoke about the politicians holding them to task. We want to knock on the churches. And I want to read this to make people understand why some of the churches don't speak out against this. In the same part where you're talking about making homosexuality lifestyle, alternative lifestyles, many nations around the world are passing laws that legalize homosexuality and gay marriage. It is now classified as hate speech, which is what we said before, and becoming illegal for ministers, listen, of 501c3 organizations, that's churches, to mention homosexuality as an abomination in the eyes of God. So they're actually preventing you from speaking out and saying it is wrong.
But we're not operating a theocracy, Mr. Lawrence. Clearly, we're not ruling along those lines. We don't have some religious individual who's presiding over St. Lucia. So why should we look at this from a standpoint of religion, from a standpoint of the Bible, or even God, morally, etc.?
Can I just answer that? The article that I read to you came out in the 1930s. This is an updated version of what I'm talking about, which is part of the WHO Comprehensive Sexuality under How Does Sex Education Impact Gender Relations? This is what the objective is. Research shows, however, that education in small and large groups can contribute to challenging and changing unequal gender norms. This United Nations statement shows they want to change our culture, our norms, whether it is people who don't like the Homosexuality Act, whether it is people who don't want to see this in our schools. It goes different ways, because everybody's sensitive in a different way. If maybe I didn't have a child, maybe I would not have known about this book. Maybe I would not be here. So for us, it's different. We're all at different levels. So when we see this on a UN level, which is a WHO, I mean, WHO is part of the UN, and this is what they're talking about, that they want to challenge and change norms. So what is this trying to tell us? Because we're not a theocracy, like you said, in this country, but at the end of the day, most of the people here follow, you know, the Judeo-Christian culture.
It's the lifeblood, okay? Which economic activity is the lifeblood of inclusion? Not the only tourism, tourism. Okay, where do most of our tourism come from? United States, Canada, and Europe. And we have these growing movements in the United States, Canada, and Europe. Don't you think that if they believe that we are opposed to the violence, don't you think that we should be? That is where the concern is. Why do you talk about we have strong values and we have resisted? Okay, look at this. We need to question things that people think we have. We can only have one opinion. That's the opinion of Israeli women. That means what they believe. And whether or not that means good or bad,
any desire, any intention
mm-hmm.
to bend.
Mm-hmm.
My apologies for this this figure of speech there.
Yeah.
But to bend to the wishes of the United States or to Europe, mm-hmm. as far as this is concerned, mm-hmm. because gay marriage is still illegal.
Mm-hmm.
Homosexuality, well, the act burglary is still illegal in St. Lucia. Don't you think that we would have taken that stance? Because they're coming under immense pressure,
mm-hmm.
but they are just not quiescing?
Well, I don't know if they've come under immense pressure yet, but I think this pressure is coming. I think perhaps among the Caribbean islands, Trinidad is advancing in this direction, and perhaps it's just a matter of time before the other Caribbean leaders, you know, follow suit. But I think what the Caribbean leaders should do, it should not be on an individual island basis. It should be collective. There should be a collective position by the Caribbean leaders, that notwithstanding what America wants or what Canada wants, it's not going to happen in our region. Just like they stood against America when the United States was trying to have the Caribbean scale back their diplomatic relations with Cuba.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, they said no. Cuba has provided us with medical assistance. Cuba has provided us with scholarships for our children. And they stood together against America. So if they do that, I believe we have a better chance of resisting any attempt to influence them in this direction than if they try to do it alone.
What about getting a clear position from our governments with regard to the comprehensive sexuality education and whether this should be added to the curriculum, Mr. Tama?
Yeah.
Do you expect that our government's Minister of Education make any clear statement on this?
Well, we have been trying to get in contact with people at the Ministry of Education. What we have, what we understood is that this is not, like you rightfully said, and we're not seeing it otherwise, that this is not part of our curriculum. However, with everything happening around the world and things happening so swiftly, and the fact that, like Fremont was saying, you've seen this happening in other bigger Caribbean islands. You've seen legislation being passed or bills being tabled in parliament in different Caribbean islands that talking about child protection, but yet still it makes it ambiguous as to who has the protection of the child, whether it's the state or the parent. So the fact that these things are coming into the forefront, people are talking, I think human rights advocates in Barbados, in Trinidad, a lot of people are speaking out, and they're saying, hey, this is part of a broader UN agenda, and we are a member of the United Nations. So we will have to accept and do according to the dictates of the UN when this thing comes through. All it takes is economic shakeup, and we have to accept.
Tim, have you ever heard about MAP or the MAPS?
Mm-hmm.
Minor Attracted Persons? There are people who are advocating that adults should be allowed to have sex with children because they are people who have a natural sexual attraction toward children. And I was watching a news item on one of the social media networks where a former FBI director was suggesting that people who oppose adults having sex with children should be prosecuted to the extent of making them bankrupt. Now we know that there are high-profile individuals who have been involved in sex with children. Case in point, Prince Andrew, the Queen's son, last year, who would have been taken to court, okay, but his mother, the Queen who has passed, paid £12 million to prevent him from going to court where he would have been convicted and possibly sent to jail. He paid £12 million. Tim, that is equivalent to about $50 million of our dollars, okay, where many scholarships could have been awarded. And then you have the Jeffrey Epstein Epstein's case where you had names like Bill Clinton and so on being mentioned. I mean, this is well documented. So we see in very high profile individuals being involved in pedophilia. And we believe that this whole trans movement, as far as it relates to children, will lead to pedophilia. And I hope at some point during the course of our discussion tonight, we get to talk about a movie that came out. It was called Sound of Freedom. You probably heard about that. That I hope we talk about that because I think that's where it's going.
But don't you think, our governments, not only in St. Lucia, but the Caribbean, you're not giving them credit
mm-hmm.
and you're not also giving the people credit, because I think they have stood fast, they have stood tall in terms of ensuring that things like pedophilia, although it's happening underground, but to a lesser extent, and also a number of other issues that that are plaguing a number of other countries, the so-called developed countries, those have not been something that is affecting us in any negative manner.
Well, Tim, a while ago I told you I believe 95% of people in St. Lucia, I think, would oppose it. So that's giving them credit. But we're telling them that there are things that perhaps they may not be aware of, and we're making them aware of, so that when there will be a barrage of information coming out, thrown at them by if you like, people from overseas, from the United States and so on, they will be aware of what we are telling them. So we are preparing them, as I said, we are preparing them for this war that is to come, for this assault on our children. And so they'll be better prepared to withstand and resist it when it comes. We're not waiting for the storm to hit us. We're preparing for the storm before it hits us.
Why do you think that officialdom, your governments, your ministers, etc., are not speaking on this sensitive and controversial subject?
Well, I think when it comes to officials, they know where the money is coming from. I mean, a lot of people say that we depend on these bigger countries, and we do. You know, we've designed our economies to depend, right? But, Tim, have you ever heard of an organization called the International Commission of Jurists?
Yes.
Okay, so basically, they now came up with a recommendation on a new set of principles, basically, to address, as far as they're concerned, harmful human rights impacts of unjustified criminalization of individuals and entire communities. Now, they're talking about marginalized communities. In one of the 21 recommendations they have, with respect to enforcement of criminal law, any prescribed minimum age of consent to sex must be applied in a non-discriminatory manner. Enforcement may not be linked to sex or gender of participants or age of consent to marriage. Moreover, sexual conduct involving persons below domestically prescribed minimum age of consent to sex may be consensual, in fact, if not in law. These are updated principles that they want us to adopt. You know, like some lawyers will say we don't have to adopt them, but these are recommendations that they're making to us. Basically, decriminalizing sex with a minor.
Mm-hmm.
You understand? When they update these type of international laws, again, Tim, the way we know the world works, these things will, just a matter of time, be trickled down to us, and it will be, have to be accepted in our law books.
But again, conventions, we have to sign those conventions and agree to abide with them.
Mm-hmm.
But in the final analysis, I think the people will have the final say on issues of that nature.
Mm-hmm.
And I think for the time being, I think we have demonstrated that we can, on these particular issues, we can stand up to the big players when it comes to things that we consider to be very unconventional and very strange to us, and things that we just will not accept.
Well, now that we're speaking about it, Tim, we are bringing this matter to the attention of the public. I'm sure that the politicians are listening. And I think what they should do to demonstrate their, if you like, resistance or their opposition to us moving in this direction, I think right now, having aired this on your program, as I said, I think they were listening, and I think they should come out and make a statement to make it very clear to the people, no. This thing has been raised. If there's going to be sex education to the extent that it is happening in the United States, we will oppose it, to give us this reassurance. Because as I said, if they do that, then we will know that they are supporting us and they are recognizing that the majority of St. Lucians are opposed to it. And I think that can only augur well for us as a people.
So therefore, do you think we should have a sex education policy? Do you think that we could go down that road, Mr. Thomas?
I think in modern policy, we should have an open discussion. The public should be able to, you know, decide, like Fremont was saying. We're not known to have referendums in this part of the world. I don't know why we say it's too costly and stuff, but at the end of the day, the people need to make that decision, because it's the people that are going to be affected. And the politicians, we know sometimes they will overlook, you know, whatever norms it is for, you know, that, how should I put it, that lifeline to continue to move for that continuity. So we cannot allow it to be, you know, something that the politicians decide. The people need to decide this. We need to talk about this. We need to bring more awareness. Just like all the other problems that we have, crime and all of these things, we need to have open discussions without prejudice, without ridiculing people and, you know, criticizing people. People need to open up to, you know, we talk about being more tolerant, but at the same time, others have to be tolerant of the fact that we are more or less a Christian country.
But if you say include the parents in this,
what
about, and teachers, what about the LGBT community, TI community? They also, they have children, whether they adopt or otherwise, and they would have to have a say. Yeah. Does that create the environment for conflict between the two groups?
No, I don't think so. I think we must approach it as mature individuals. We recognize that we have an LGBT group in St. Lucia. As I said earlier on, I don't hate them. I don't think we should hate them. I don't think there should be any violence against them. We should treat them as human beings. And if we're going to have a national discussion on sex education in the schools, I think they should be included, because we want to hear. We cannot isolate them. We cannot say, you know, that they are not they are less than human, or we don't want to hear what their views are. I think they should be included, because that is the only way we can come up with a policy, a position.
So then you're open-minded.
I'm open-minded.
You don't have any set position on this as to whether it should be taught in our schools or not, Mr. Turner?
Whether sex education should be taught in our schools?
Yes.
Yeah, but certain there should be certain guidelines as to what you're teaching and to what age you're teaching it. At what age certain elements of the sex, certain aspects of sex should be introduced to children. Mm-hmm. I don't think you can have, for example, 5-year-olds and 10-year-olds and 12-year-olds together and teaching them the same thing.
Not only that, I think parents should have the ability to opt out. So in other words, if I don't want my child to be exposed to this, and this is that particular class, then I don't want my child to be part of it. They should have that right.
Okay. But how do you expect that we will just be find ourselves in a position where we're just totally not exposed to that kind of teaching, the CSE? Mm-hmm. When, for example, so many of our students now have to study overseas, broaden their horizon, they eventually will be subjected to this. And sometimes if you go overseas and attend the age of 12, 13, you will be exposed automatically.
Well, I don't think
that's something that you really cannot run away from.
Well, as I said, Tim, I'm not opposed to sexual education, but I think it should be structured such that parents and teachers have an input. All right, because as you rightly say, we have students who leave and go overseas and who will be exposed to things that they were not necessarily exposed here in St. Lucia, and so we must prepare them. But again, it must be done gradually. The point I'm making is that teaching certain aspects of sex to 12 and 15 year olds cannot be taught to children who are 4 and 5 years.
But you might be seeing it as pornography, but isn't it the context in which those subject matters are exposed to the trend in terms of even the pictorial aspect of it?
Mm.
Do you think we must look at the context and not see it as pornographic material?
Well, in some cases, if you're teaching children who are 12 and 15 year olds, certain things that perhaps would be considered pornography for 4 and 5 year olds may not be considered pornography for 15 and 16 year olds. I think that's because children are exposed to a lot. Children have a smartphone, and they're exposed to a lot of stuff that parents don't even know that they've been exposed to. So that is why I believe that there needs to be sex education. And for the children to be provided with guidance as to what they are watching and how it is likely to affect them, okay? And so I also believe, Tim, that sex education in our culture for a long time was a taboo subject. Parents didn't even know how to approach it, you know? So parents themselves have to be taught how to approach this subject with their children, because they believe perhaps they just leave it to the whims of the child goes out and the child learns about, and sometimes the child comes back home
doing certain things that you never expected the child to do. You know, because the parents themselves never received proper sex education, so they don't know how to impart that to the children. So the sex education that I'm thinking about is not just structured toward dealing with children, but to tell parents how to proceed with exposing or introducing sex education to the children. So it has to be on, you know, approached in different ways.
What we'll do right now is to put the telephone number on screen so that you can call with your questions and comments for my two guests. Once again, Fremont Lawrence of Freedom Coalition St. Lucia and Jason Tama, a concerned parent. We're here focusing on comprehensive sexuality education, CSE, where it is felt that certain subject matters should not be taught to children of a particular age, because that will only influence them in a particular direction. And also, if you have to go down the route of introducing comprehensive sexuality education in the curriculum, the school curriculum, then parents, according to my two guests, should have an input as well.
Parent and teachers.
But in the meantime, that is an issue that is not being addressed by the authorities in St. Lucia in particular, your Ministry of Education, and so on. So you just see it as an opportunity to be proactive in terms of addressing that subject matter. Mm-hmm. But in the long run, do you expect that any government, considering that governments always think about the next general election, the next voting cycle, will want to introduce such subject matters in our education system?
Well, it can be introduced, but with the input of parents mm-hmm. and teachers. And it's a good thing you mentioned the election, because if parents demonstrate if you like a certain level of maturity in terms of dealing with this matter, then the politicians have to be careful. So one of the things that we're thinking of doing, Tim, is to organize like a rally, right, and call parents and teachers, and to have them, if it's not going to be done by our government, I think we may as well take the initiative and organize it for the community. So bring in teachers and bring in parents. Let's discuss this issue, find out what your concerns are and what we would like, how we'd like to engage the government, because we're not keeping out the government. We'd like to engage them, the Ministry of Education, the Ministry of Health, okay, the Prime Minister even, in terms of bringing this matter to the public.
We have a call on line. Good evening to you. This is Newsmaker Live. You're on the air. Hello?
Let's see. Good evening to you, Mr. Fremont.
Good evening to you, caller.
Good evening to you, Mr. Fremont. Good evening to your team. Okay.
Okay, my guests, they're not hearing, but we'll just continue. Yeah, go ahead, please.
I'm not hearing.
She's talking. I can't hear anything you're saying, so if you're talking, I can't.
Yes, go ahead, please. Go ahead.
I beg your pardon?
Yes, continue.
I beg your pardon?
Continue, caller. Go ahead, please.
Okay. So, again, good evening. In respect to sex education in schools, we need to revisit this whole thing. We need to look at that whole situation.
Mm-hmm.
We need to, first of all, remove prayers from organizations, from institutions, from schools, from the House of Parliament, those places. We need to remove prayers, because one of the main causes of violence in the country, in the world, is religion. I will not say anything further on that. Now, going back to sex education.
But again, why should you remove prayers, caller? You're saying you're saying remove prayers from the parliament and other institutions?
No, why? That's exactly what she said.
Yeah.
Okay. That's what's bringing division, causing all of the problems in the world.
In what way is it bringing division?
Who are we praying to? You have one country, will tell you they're not giving loans to anybody from the LGBT community. You have another one that will say, once you, if you kill somebody, you're at fault. If you have sex with a minor, you're at fault. That's not what it is. To each his own. If I come from a particular tribe in Africa, and in that tribe, I'm accustomed, what I've been taught is to have sex with minors, with anybody from the ages of maybe 5 to 12 or something, so under the age of 18. To me, in my culture, it is okay, it is alright. I happen to move from my home and travel somewhere else. I have that same culture. I keep my culture. Means alive, I won't do it. They're gonna take me down, they'll tell me I've written the law or all kinds of things they have to say. So what I'm saying to each and all, we just have to learn to love and respect people. People come into our country, we have to understand where they come from, understand their lifestyle, etc., and respect it. In terms of sex education in school, which is where I was heading to, I have 2 children. My first is a teenager, and my young is a youngster, a very young child. Because of how I was brought up, I did not know better. You find I brought up my teenage son 1 week with what I have been taught. I'm a staunch religious person, from Catholic to Pentecostal. So he's 1 week. Now I have my other son. I raised him totally different. Because now I'm a little more educated. From the tender age of a year and a half, I started introducing my son, because he was much younger, to sex, sexual activities, different religious organization, all of that. I taught them that you respect everybody, you respect.
Okay, ma'am, so you say, as far as the comprehensive sexuality education, do you think that this should be introduced or being part of the school curriculum?
I beg your pardon?
Do you think that matters really, the comprehensive sexuality education, whereby things relating to the LGBTQ community and so on, that should be exposed to students or children at a tender age?
Absolutely, absolutely. We're supposed to introduce, and not even just in schools. Not even just in schools. When we have our sons and the mothers are going to prenatal care classes or what have you, before another clinic, from there, we're supposed to have persons at those clinics to talk to those mothers, whether they're young mothers, grown-up mothers, whatever, to talk to those women from the time they're pregnant. That's teaching them that as they go home, they can continue reading upon it, learning about it. When they get built, they talk to their children about it. They will not be ashamed, because that's what religion teaches us, especially within the Catholic and the Muslim community. That's what they teach us. We're not supposed to talk about sex and whether it's heterosexual, homosexual, bestiality. We're not supposed to talk about these things because it's wrong. They even tell you in the quote-unquote book they call the Bible, I call it just a history book, in that book they even tell you you're not supposed to pleasure yourself, that it is wrong. All of these things, that's what they do. They just try to keep us down. Imagine they come, they give us a Bible, and with that Bible, they beat us, they do us all kind of things.
Alright, thank you so much for calling, ma'am. Alright, we have some slight technical issue, we want to rectify it, so we will take a quick break, and the broadcast will continue in just a moment. You are watching Newsmaker Live on DBS Television.
Right.
Thank you so much for seeing the broadcast. I think we have somebody on the line who's been holding on for a while. Good evening to you. This is Newsmaker Live. Hello. Hello. Good evening to you, caller. Okay, what was that call? So let's see if we try another line. Good evening to you, Newsmaker Live. You're on the air. Hello.
Hello.
Hi. Good evening to you, caller.
Hello.
Yes. Good evening.
Hello.
Yes. Good evening to you, caller.
Can you hear me?
Loud and clear, caller. Go ahead, please.
Hello.
Hello.
She cannot hear you, obviously.
Okay. So the caller. Hello.
Okay. Timothy. Good night.
Good evening to you, caller.
And good evening to your
My guests, Mr. Freeman Lawrence. Of Freedom Coalition, St. Lucia, and Jason Tama.
Interesting topic, and I know that this was coming to pass, and it will come to pass because we have to gear up for that. Tim, however, I still feel that you should have had probably a member of the Christian Council on that,
on the panel.
Panel, yes, because that way, a lot more would have been able to balance out, because the lady who came there a while ago, she made her thoughts known, but what she is speaking about there, and if that is what the world is going to be turning into, we are coming into chaos. She says there should not be prayer in areas, there should not be, let me tell you, without God amongst us and without God in the forefront. Although sometimes we in Parliament we have we have prayer, and persons go anti what they think and anti what they believe. But when you look at it carefully, Timothy, when they do that, don't you notice that things go wrong? If we don't continue, because if you notice, they took out prayers in school. What's happening in schools? Wherever we take out prayer, wherever we try to keep God out of, Satan jumps in. And that is exactly what will be happening. She was saying that if she's from a country where her culture dictates that she does certain things, she can go to anywhere else and do it. So if she is a cannibal in Africa, she can come to St. Lucia and be a cannibal. The people you just seen people disappearing, and you don't know what's happening. But all that time, there's a cannibal among us eating people. They continue their culture, and that's okay. No, we have to have the culture in our country. We have to have laws in our country to deter people from doing what they want. This is what the laws are for, and we have to start from now. And the gentleman said that we have to really, come out and show that we are not in agreement with this. And Timothy, I am really sorry for our little children. I thought these little kids would have been protected, but I'm seeing it coming, and we have to make sure that we protect those little ones. How you can tell me a big man of 45 can decide that he wants to go and sleep with a 6-year-old? No. Or even I'm 6-year-old as a boy, or 6-year-old as a girl. No, it's wrong. And so we have to place those laws. And I'm happy with these gentlemen coming out and making us aware of what's coming. And it's not only just children, but it comes with animals too. Because I've noticed now a lot of what's happening on the media, especially on the networks. You see a lot of animals are now being used, people sleeping with animals. Animals are turning in, like, they're dressing them like children. We have to be careful. It's coming slowly but surely. And so I am happy with these gentlemen coming out and making us aware of it. And when it comes for us to come out to stand against these things, I hope that we can all do it. Timothy, have a good night.
You too, ma'am. Thank you so much for calling. Is it Tama?
Yeah.
Your comments, your reaction?
Based on what she said,
yeah.
Well, I mean, we all in agreement, and like she, we see in the fear.
Yeah.
We see what's coming, for our children.
We have a call. Good evening to you. This is Newsmaker Live. You're on the air. Hi, good evening to you, caller.
Yes, good evening, Timothy, and your two guests.
Good evening.
Good evening to them.
Good evening.
Well, my take on this is that God, in the book of Genesis, Genesis 1:26, God made male and female. We were created in the image of God, male and female, and the Lord blessed the male and female, he said to them, be fruitful and multiply. Now, two men cannot bring four children. Two female cannot bring four children. So I have a question. If God made male and female, who made the homosexuals? I want to believe, you see, now it's time parents need to wake up. Wake up and stand up and fight against what is happening. Fight for your children. In the book of Luke 17, I believe 29, God speak about this. He said, so in the days of Noah, so in the days of Sodom and Gomorrah, so it will be in the last days. Human family, you need to wake up. You think this is a joke, what is happening worldwide? It will get on the island. It will be worse. It has to come. Bible prophecy must be fulfilled. We just need to get ready and get our children ready. And your first caller that call, she sung like really like a fool. We must pray for her. Have a blessed night.
Thank you so much for calling. We continue with our broadcast and await some of your calls. We have another call online already. Good evening, Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Good evening, Tim.
Good evening to you, caller.
Good evening to your guest.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I think what the guests are, the topic that has come to hand is a very important topic. It's something that we definitely need to start talking about.
Mm.
And in fact, some of the callers are talking about the fact that it is coming. I dare say it's already here.
Mm-hmm. Why would you say that, caller?
We as adults are not having these conversations, but I can assure you that children are. Mm-hmm. Social media has brought it here already. Mm-hmm. They are exposed to it. They are discussing it. They're talking about it in the schools. They're talking about it among themselves, about LGBT, about LGBTQA, etc., etc. They're talking about it, whether it's right to be with another girl and whether it's right to be with another boy. They're talking mm-hmm. about it. They're having this conversation. You know, if not with the adults, they're having this conversation among themselves. And sadly, we the adults,
but
I'm not
don't you think,
having this
conversation. Don't you think that's all the reason why we should have CSE, Comprehensive Sexuality Education, to include all those subjects?
Well, I think some form of sexual education is important, but you see, my problem is the slippery slope. And the slippery slope is what has caused quite a bit of issues in the Americas, where you have them wanting to introduce these sort of things to children who are extremely too small to handle it.
You there, Colin?
So, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I was saying my issue is drawing the line and not having a slide off the slippery slope. Because you have persons thinking that a one-year-old is able to have those kind of discussions, and they want to open up a one-year-old and a two-year-old, you know, to, you know, sexuality and sex itself. Not just educate them on sex, but open them up to sex. And it's a little scary with what we're seeing worldwide, and, you know, governments actually legislating certain things, you know, legislating whether or not you can quote-unquote misgender an individual. So yes, it's coming. Also, it's already there, in the sense that social media has brought it to especially the younger generation, who is always on social media, and they are discussing it.
Take, for example, in the chat room, somebody has written, all the time we were taught about male and female, two genders, where all the others come from. And it continues there with, so what we were taught was wrong.
Well, in relation,
so what? So what we were taught before were lies then.
Well, you see, we live in a world where everybody believes in being certainly, or you know, enlightened, and they believe that just because there's information out there, the information is true. And of course, we're all going to be selectively biased to whatever we want to look at. But most definitely, nature teaches us that there is always just male and female. If an individual wants to not accept that, that's them. But you see, when an individual talks about religion, and culture and religion, of course, influence politics. But when somebody talks about religion, what I'm seeing now is the LGBTQ and all the other letters after it is now seemingly becoming a religion. So we need to have these conversations, because this thing runs deeper than just saying we agree or we disagree. And we have to be careful, because as culture itself influences politics, of course it goes down into legislation. As you saw Canada recently wanting to jail people if you simply call an individual and the person wants to be called he, even if they look like a she, by all measures and standards, or she. So I hope we don't get to that point. And definitely we need to, I'm happy the gentleman has started the conversation, and other persons hopefully will follow through to ensure that we keep this thing at a standard, that we do not go off the deep end.
Okay, Father. Thank you.
Tim, I want to make a point, yeah. Tim. This thing is more serious than we imagine it to be. One of the things that's happening right now is you have men who have been men all their lives and now saying that they're women and they are being allowed to take part in women's sports and they're beating the women. Mm-hmm. We have a case of Canada and the States. Yeah. This guy has more beard than a male goat, okay? And yet he's being allowed to participate in a weightlifting competition with women. He's beating the women. The same case with a guy who has been a man all his life, being allowed to take part in a swimming race,
beauty contest as well,
and beauty contest, but in the case of a swimming race, he ties with a woman, but yet they award the prize to the guy who is the trans man. What this is doing, Tim, is it's setting the stage for women's sports to be destroyed, because what you have happening is more men transing into women than women transing into men. So, and I think this whole thing is designed to make the role of women obsolete, and that is not acceptable, because male and female is at the core of what we are as humans. And when we begin to undermine the role of women in our society and the role that they can play, we are undermining our society, and we must be very careful about that.
Good evening to you, Newsmaker Live. Thanks for holding on. You're on the air now.
Good night to you, and good night to your guests. I hope that you can hear me clearly.
Good evening to you, caller. Good night. I can hear you. We can hear you. We can all hear you.
So, I just wanted to say that I appreciate the guests that you have on and the contributions that they have made to this discussion, which is not only international but globally. And I really appreciate the contributions that your previous callers have made to this discussion. But my concern is that this is something which calls into question, and I'm really concerned as a parent of a five-year-old, what contribution is it that the religious institutions, and maybe I should probably say faith-based, because we're primarily a Christian community, a Christian country. We have holidays which are influenced by Catholicism and I'm speaking about Whit Monday and Corpus Christi, and even Christmas Day. And what contribution is it that our faith-based organizations have made to this discussion, to help streamline it, bring it along, and to help bring to light what they call their core faith, which is the Bible?
So you think, you there, ma'am? Hello?
Hello?
Yes. So you think definitely by now that discussion should have been led by faith-based organizations?
Should have been involved, yes. It should have been.
Hello?
Yes, I can barely hear you, but what I want to know is what contribution have our faith-based organizations made to this discussion?
Okay. All right. Thank you so much.
Tim, what we're going to do, as Sissy mentioned, faith-based organizations, we're going to send out an open letter to all parents, teachers, faith-based organizations, to tell them it is time for you to be engaged in this discussion, because it's going to have a tremendous impact on our society. So it's an open letter to all of them, and we're going to call them to a rally for us to have a heart-to-heart conversation on this matter.
Good evening to you, Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Hello, good evening.
Hi, good evening to you, caller.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm going to move swiftly into it. The conversation started with the comprehensive sexual education, and I could understand why it moved directly into morality, burdened by a conversation about God, because God is the number one morality giver. So our major problem in our society right now is we have two conflicting moral stances. One morality says that truth is subjective, and another morality, the belief in God, is saying that there is an objective way of living life. So I'm thinking that we're moving too fast into God and that idea of things. I think we should just rationalize and think of these things very particularly. So let's take a scenario, case in point. If you have 1,000 gay men, you put them on an island, and you leave them there for 100 years. If you come back, will there be any sort of life? No. From that point of view, it is left to reason that the idea of men and men and women and women is a dead idea. It is not an idea of life. But we build our society. Our society is built to generate ideas that keep life moving forward. So if we are going to build a society with 50 or 60% of individuals that are living or participating in dead ideas, we are going towards societal destruction. So we need other people to think about whether we want our society to be a living entity, a living system, or are we participating in the reduction of life and population control? Those are the questions we should be asking ourselves before we run too far into talking about religion. Because religion has its situations where it has its problems. But there are principles in life that people need to abide by. And if they don't abide by those principles, destruction starts with the family, then it goes to the community, then it goes to the civilization and the culture. And we have this destruction of human nature, humanity all together. So people need to be very careful with the ideas that they peddle and the ideas that they want to defend if they don't understand the final analysis of those ideas.
Thank you so much, sir. Gentlemen?
Yeah. Well, I'm in total agreement. Even the caller, one of the sisters, spoke about the fact that we were made to procreate. You understand? You know, Tim, that we have low population births right now. So imagine the human race is being put. Basically, we're jeopardizing our own selves by having a generation that's going to have less babies. What are they trying to do? Have fake babies so we don't, as humans, have babies the way we were meant to be?
Good evening, Newsmaker Live, you're on the air.
Hi, good evening.
Hi, good evening to you, caller.
Yes, good evening to you and your gentleman. I think people are getting carried away. We're not talking about adults, we're talking about children. Good evening, Tim, can you hear me?
Yes, loud and clear, caller.
Yes. Yeah, good evening.
Yes, so good evening to everyone. I think people are jumping the gun. We're not talking about adults. What adults do in their own home, that's it. We're talking about kids. And as a parent, I'm very, very concerned about that. They tried to bring that into the education system before. People are not aware of. The teachers stood against it. That is one of the reasons why it was not implemented in Tenerife. And about sex education, there are many books you can buy that are age appropriate. I have daughters.
Okay.
And I comb through Amazon. We get the book, tell them about menstruation. And they taught that at school, reproduction. That is fine. There is no reason to teach my child about any other sex thing. That's not what it is, and it's not even religion. And we are tolerant. I think that's what happened. We are tolerant that everybody has a right. So a gay person walking down the street had the right to walk down the street without being discriminated against. But this has gone so far now that they want to make it normal and let children know that it is normal. If us after school, an 18, 19-year-old is not sure about what they want to do. They have the age now to decide that. Before this, let the children be children.
Yes.
There is no reason for that. And then as a parent, we know a lot of us, it's not even just that. They're setting them up to be ripe for pedophiles. That's another issue. Over-sexualizing children. If they had to carry out a survey in school, you'd see the amount of children that are having sex at 10, 11, 12. It's wrong, boy or girl. And that is part of the thing, over-sexualizing children and making it all right, making them think that it's all right. You get households where children, 10-year-olds are watching porn and going and practice it on their 10 and 6-year-old
sisters.
This is happening in St. Lucia.
Yeah.
So sex education is fine, letting the children know about their bodies and with growing up what is supposed to happen. But bringing those books in and then making them see those graphic images of all of that. We are in San Lucia where we know a lot of gay people. I think most people have a friend who is gay. So it's not even a conversation about gay. It's trying to make it all right and then confusing the children and making them choose that path early, even some of them who may not have known. We don't even have an issue with gay teachers in school. We have a problem with pedophiles. That's the biggest issue, what it's setting up, and then pushing that breakdown of family. And it has nothing to do in church. I am teaching my children, there are only two genders, men and female. But you see that person walking down the street and they all hate, there's nothing wrong with that. But my daughter should not go to any bathroom, and it happened here in St. Lucia, where they have to be with those men in. What should happen is those guys, even when they dress as females, should be able to go to the men toilet and not be harassed. That is why it's supposed to be. They're not supposed to be harassed, but they're not supposed to be in the washroom with my daughter.
Precisely.
So let's not get ahead of it. Adults, their decisions, what they do in their bedroom. Children, it's a different thing. So a lot of us parents applaud you, gentlemen. We do not want that in our school to be taught to our children. We do not want those books and then all of that LGBTQ++ thing to be indoctrinated to our children. Thank you very much.
All right, thank you very much.
Tom, I need to say, she made an important one. Let children be children. Let children have the divine innocence, the innocence. When you begin to introduce certain things to them, you violate that divine right. Now, here is something I want to say. While we express concern, already we are encouraged by what we see happening in the U.S. Because you've heard about Bud Light and Dylan Mulvaney, who was used as a personality to promote Bud Light. There was a backlash against Bud Light, and as a result, Bud Light has lost its status as the number one beer in America. Target and Ben and Jerry's, the same thing happened to them. So we have people beginning to resist this indoctrination. You're using your brand to try and impose your ideology on people are rejecting it. And I think there's a growing wave against that right now. And I think this wave is going to catch St. Lucia.
We have a call. Good evening, Newsmaker Live, you're on the air. Hello.
Hello, good evening.
Yes, good evening to you, caller.
Doesn't listen to you. Boy, Timothy, we have a long way to go, my goodness. I have been hearing a lot of hypocrisy, of this program. Timothy, let me just say, I'm going to be real quick. Let me just tell you. Speak up for soon. Mr. Fremont mentioned something about
Well, I can't hear you too clearly. Yeah. I don't know if you're not speaking directly into your phone.
I'm not hearing clearly.
Okay. I'm saying, earlier on, I know Mr. Fremont mentioned something about the sports athlete.
Yeah.
What I am saying, the sum up, what I am saying, if a person wants to be considered, as whatever gender, male, female, whatever it is, that's up to them. Yeah? It's not our responsibility to say, oh, well, you're born male, so you must be considered or called a he. Or you're born with a vagina, so we have to call you a she. No. As a matter of fact, let me tell you, when a person is born, because a person is born with a penis, we automatically say, you're a boy. You're born with a vagina, you're a girl. And so we start dressing you. We even have certain colors. So if you have a penis, we're going to dress you in blue, in white, in yellow. You have a vagina, we're going to dress you up in pink and those colors. We have colors for females, colors for males. No. Right? As a person grows, let them develop into whatever they want. We can only guide them, teach them, talk to them, but let that be up to them. And whatever they choose, let's just respect it and support them. Right? Now, the other thing I wanted to say...
So, Cola, how do you identify? Cola, are you male or female? Do you identify yourself as male or female?
Well, I happen to identify myself as a she.
A she? So you're female?
I identify myself as a she. However, I was about to say, we just learn to respect every life, respect their beliefs. We need to put, what we can do as a state, is to put measures in place to control and protect and to teach or to educate
people. Like I said earlier on, when we have a person going to prenatal care, from that point, from that stage onwards, because of how we have been raised, it's very simple for us to change, for us to evolve. We start teaching them from there, from that point onwards. Understand? We always let them give birth, and then when they, after they give birth, they bring up their children the same way they were brought. We are persons to not can educate. Let us start educating from there and put persons in school, personnel in schools that can help to uplift and to help us evolve as better homosexuals that we are supposed to be. Thank you very much and have a good night. Timothy, I will talk to you when I see you.
Okay.
When I get back.
All right, thank you so much for calling.
I didn't.
Yeah, but yes. I mean, what you're saying is that if you have a child being born, male or female, do not try to indoctrinate that child into believing that they are male or female. Allow them to grow up as human beings, mm-hmm. and then at some point in time, they will make up their minds as to whether they are male or female. Although they have a penis, their genitalia would indicate that they have a vagina or a penis. This is very confusing.
So if a child takes something that doesn't belong to them, mm-hmm. what do you do then? Do you allow them to be? And they will just grow up taking things from people and thinking it's okay? I mean, you have to have some kind... I mean, if that's what she wants to do.
Because you say that you have a preconceived notion that if you have a boy, automatically everything you buy for that child in terms of the clothing and so on will be in blue. So you're giving the impression that child will grow up to be a male. But who knows, he will change his mindset as far as to whether it's male or female.
Mm. But how can you change your mindset? I mean, you're born male. I mean, that notion or that theory that, you know, your gender is not decided upon and you can change your gender. I mean, where does it stop? Because if you decide one day you want to become an animal, you know, where do we stop?
Anyway, let's take the final comments from you, gentlemen. Let's start with you, Mr. Tama.
Yeah, well, for us, Tim, I mean, we've had this system for thousands of years, male and female, whether you want to look at it from a religious standpoint or you just want to look at it from a natural standpoint. We have people who have never been involved in any kind of religion, let alone Judeo-Christian belief system, and they follow in that same manner, male and female, and they know what it means to procreate. So again, we have problems down the line if we do not continue to multiply. You know, for us, some of us want to see our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren. You know, we might have a generation that will not be able to procreate. You know, so we don't want that to happen to our small island, obviously, because it would be detrimental. But for us as parents, we don't want to see our rights being taken away by the state or by anybody else and telling our children or programming our children what to do, what to think, and what not to think.
Mr. Lawrence, final comments?
Yeah, Tim, thanks for the opportunity that we had this evening, and thanks for the callers. Again, my main concern is about the influence that is trying to dictate to our children whether they should be male or female. We send our children to school to be educated, not indoctrinated in accordance with the transgender ideology. And I think the conversation that we have started here today, I think it should continue. I think the politicians should get involved because they have children also. They have boys, they have girls, and I think they are part of the community, and it should be that also. What I'd like to do, Jim, I've always felt this very, very close connection with children, and I've always felt that they need to be protected against nefarious influences in the life. And I composed a poem one time. Let me just very, very, you know, just say, it goes like this, Tim. Children are like flowers. They are lovely to behold. They need our love and caring to help themselves unfold, or they wither and they waste away. And we must ask ourselves, are we ready for the choice we make to bring them in the world? And so we must ask ourselves these questions. You know, we have a responsibility, a divine responsibility, to look after our children. This is the responsibility that God gave us. And we must not allow negative influences to influence the child before the child is ready for these influences. And so we have a responsibility to demand our right as parents not be violated, and to not have our children violated by the transgender ideology. Thank you very much.
Mr. Freeman Lawrence, thank you so much for being my guest, as well as Mr. Jason Tama. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Thank you very
and
much.
To you, as always, thank you so much for watching the broadcast and contributing via your calls and your contribution in the chat. It's Newsmaker Live. Time now for the clip that peaked.
Hey, Dad.
Yeah?
I have a question.
Okay, what's your question?
Why do girls rub their eyes when they wake up?
Why do girls rub their eyes when they wake up?
Yeah.
I don't know.
Because they have no balls to scratch.
That's the broadcast. Once again, thank you so much for watching. It's a very good evening. My name is Timothy Paul. I'm saying good night. See you next time.
I, Philip, I would like to be judged as being the Prime Minister, not being judged as being part.